Hi everybody, welcome back to the Enterprise App Pattern series of videos. And in this video, we're going to be talking about the cost optimization pillar of the reliable web app pattern. All right, so let's go back in time just a little bit. This is the reference architecture that we deployed. And there is a lot there. There's Azure Front Door, there's two app services, there's Azure Cache for Redis, there's Azure Storage, there's app configuration, there's app insights, there's a key vault. There's multiple regions. And so one thing that when we're deploying this and when we're developing it, we want to be sure that we're cost optimized, both to make sure that we are optimizing our costs, but yet still meeting all of our business objectives. We want to balance our business goals with the overall budget, and we want to reduce any unnecessary expenses and improve any operational efficiencies that we can. In other words, we want to do more with less. So a part of that is that we want to make sure we choose the correct resources for the job. We also want to optimize workloads and aim for any scalable costs that we can. In other words, we want to be able to scale up when we need it and also scale down when we don't. And then we want to dynamically allocate and de-allocate resources. So be able to get a resource into production when we need it and be able to get rid of it all automatically. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about picking the correct resources, specifically in getting a specific service level availability or SLA that we commit to our customers. So in this case, we want to hit an availability of 99.9% of the time. So how do we go about and calculate that? So what we do is that for each one of the Azure resources that we have, and I realize it's a little bit of an eye chart over on the left-hand side, to calculate the SLA of our total solution that has all those Azure resources in, you take each one of those, like for Front Door, 99.990, and then for Entra ID, 99.990, you multiply those together and you get 99.98. So a resource or a solution that has just Front Door and Entra ID in it has the availability of 99.98% of the time. All right, our application has a lot more in there. We have App Service, Redis Cache, Azure SQL, and so on. And you can see the SLAs of each one of their services as well. So you go down, you multiply those all together. And when we do that, we find out that our application has an availability of 99.546% of the time. And that comes out to be 39 hours of downtime a year, which is a little bit more than what our clients and our bosses have agreed to. So what we want to do is that we can make that better, increase our overall availability by adding another region to it. And there's an actual formula available to calculate that with. And that formula is 1 minus 1 minus n raised to the r. Okay, so let's explain that just for a little bit. So let's concentrate in on the 1 minus n. The n in this case is the original SLA that we calculated by multiplying all the services together. So it's 1 minus 0.99546, right? So we get that number. Then we raise it to the number of regions we want to have within our overall composite. So here we'll just do 2, so we'll square that. Then we take that number, subtract it from 1, and then we get 99 point something. And here the case would be probably 99.99, but because we are going to be behind a Front Door, we had to multiply that, and then we'll get 99.98%. Make sense? It's a long way of saying, use the 1 minus 1 minus n raised to the r, and don't forget to also add in Azure Front Door at the end because you have to route the traffic to the appropriate spots. All right, so right now I want to take a look back at how we deployed reliable web apps. Specifically, I want to take a peek at the bicep files. Here are all of the files, the scripts, and the bicep files that have come with the reliable web app patterns code. Now, I want to show off the main bicep file. So main.bicep is the entry point for the infrastructure deployment. Now, what I really want to point out is that bicep files, they're infrastructure as code. And I really want to talk about the code part of it. Right here on line 6, we're declaring a variable. This is a parameter that's being passed in. Further on down, there's more variables going on. We have right here on line 25 an if statement where we check to see if the passed in variable is true or not, and then setting another variable with it. So here's where we really get going. I'm now looking at the Azure Redis cache.bicep file. So this is creating an Azure Redis cache as it's named, but here's what's really neat about it. If I scroll down a little bit, I'm initiating a variable called Redis cache SKU name. And then I'm setting, based on what's coming in for isProd, which is a parameter, I'm going to set that Redis cache SKU name to be either standard or basic. And then in my SKU, where I deploy the Redis cache, it's going to have the SKU of standard or basic. So depending on whether it's prod or not. So all the way back when I deploy with Azure AZD Developer CLI, I could set isProd to be true or not. And that gets passed into my main.bicep file, which eventually makes it down to the Redis cache bicep file, which eventually determines the SKU or the pricing level or the availability of how big the resources are and so on of features in Redis cache. And so my developer version of Redis that I'm using for development doesn't necessarily have to be as expensive or as full-featured as my production version. It just has to suit my developer needs, which is really nice. Okay, so now I want to take a look at other things that we're doing in the bicep files as well. So one thing is that I just mentioned was the Azure Redis cache, where we're checking out which SKU to assign based on the isProd variable, standard or basic, and then setting it over to the SKU. And what's really nice about this is that developer costs are 16% of production, but they have similar behavior. So perfectly fine for development, but way, way less expensive. So when we aim for scalable costs, this is what I want to talk about, is this resource in Bicep is a web app scale rule. But what I want to point out here is this. This web app scale rule gets applied to an app service. And it's saying, you know what? I'm going to allow you to scale from 1 to 10 based on rules that I define below it. So Bicep is infrastructure as code, and I'm declaratively setting out a bunch of rules so I can go through and read what would cause my app service to have to scale or not. So I'm aiming here for my scalable costs, and I'm defining what would happen in a repeatable manner. So I could deploy this to prod, I could deploy this to dev if I wanted to, and I could use that we looked at before, some if statements, some conditional statements, to have this change in dev if I wanted to. And I want to dynamically allocate and deallocate as well. So one thing here is notice the is multiple region deployment. So in my AZ CLI deployment initially, I can specify whether I want to have a secondary Azure location and where it should be. If it's right here, if it's saying if it's nothing, if it's been passed in a null string, it's going to set a variable of is multi-location deployment to false. Otherwise, it sets it to true. And then further down in a second set of code there, what it's saying then is, you know what? If it's true, give a secondary resource module the same thing you gave to the first resource module, the main one. And then what it's going to do is just set it up the exact same thing we deployed in our first Azure region. It's going to deploy it again in our second Azure region. So this allows us to create an entire group of resources, all based on the same resource.bicep file, but in a secondary Azure region. And because we're using infrastructure as code, we can tear it down just as easily with Azure Dev CLI by doing AZD down. So let's take a look at that and how that would happen. All right, so when we deployed our infrastructure via the Azure Developer CLI, AZD Provision, and AZD Deploy, we can delete everything as well using AZD Down. So just by typing AZD Down from the same directory where we deployed from, I can go through and get rid of everything. So it's going to go through and ask me to create a deployment plan, get everything that it wants to get rid of, and just say, you know what, I'm going to delete 42 resources. Are you sure you want to go? And in this case, yes. And that's how I would get rid of a bunch of resources, scale my development costs way down. And what's nice about this is that the Azure Developer CLI, or AZD, runs the same way that I would be running GitHub Actions if I was running in production with GitHub Actions. That is running bicep files, and it's deploying code using the .NET CLI and everything like that. So it's the same experience and the same process, both development and in production. So that was a quick exploration of the cost optimization pillar of the Reliable Web App Pattern. We took a quick peek on choosing the correct resources and also how to optimize workloads for scalable costs and looking at how to dynamically allocate and de-allocate resources.